Happy Easter! Come on, he's risen! Come on, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords is risen, and we worship him this morning. I don't know about you, but I got joy in my heart. I got praise that I want to lift up. Come on, church, do you want to lift up some praise to him this morning? Amen. Let's put our hands together.
stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and dine with him, and he with me.
Jesus.
up a shout of praise this morning. Come on to the risen King, King Jesus. Oh. Thank you, Jesus. Can we scoot in real fast, everybody? We got a lot of people still trying to get in. If there's a seat in between you, we just scoot in and close it. We want everyone to know that they have a place here. We want to let people get in. Thank you.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name is stands above them all. Jesus, all thrones, into dominions, all power, and positions. Your name stands above them all. In the angels' cry.
in church this morning? Yes? My name's Lincoln. I'm one of the pastors here at Bridgeway, and I want to say on behalf of our whole staff, we are so glad that you guys are here this morning. And listen, if you, maybe this is your first time ever being inside of a church. Man, we want to say we are so glad that you are here. And more importantly than that, God is glad that you're here today. And the way we do it around here is whether you've been here one time or 1,000 times, we consider you family. And so make yourselves at home. Hopefully you feel like you belong here because we believe that you do. Church, he is risen. This is it, right? This is the most important event in history. This is it. Well, listen, I'm going to ask you to do something. We still have more people. What a cool thing. We have more people trying to come in. And if you have any seats in between you, if you can just scooch together, and if the ushers come down your road, just go, yeah, I've got one here. Let's just make a little bit more space for people who are still coming in. All right, awesome. Well, listen, we are going to sing a song about God's faithfulness. And I don't know about you, but how many would just by a show of hands would say, God has been faithful to me? Come on, God has been faithful to me. And listen, I am living, breathing proof that God can take somebody with a super jacked up past and still do something with their life for his kingdom. And I did not grow up in church. I was least likely to ever become a Christian. In high school, I won that award, let alone become a pastor. But I'll tell you what, God has been good to me. My wife and I, next month, are celebrating 30 years of marriage. God is good. He who has found a wife has found a good thing. I love my wife. She's here. Hi, honey. I love you. And we've got two beautiful sons. And I'll tell you what, we would not have been married for 30 years if it wasn't for Jesus in my life. That's just straight up. And so we want for every single one of you to experience the love, grace, mercy, and forgiveness of God this Easter. And if you don't have a relationship with Jesus, our highest prayer is that you would leave here with one. And so just be open to what he might show you and say to you this Easter. All right, you guys ready to sing? Come on, are you ready to sing?
Fall, major, my heart and soul are praising. Hallelujah. Come on. great in love. And I just wanna say thank you to you. You pulled me from my clay. You've given me a brand new day. Now all that I can say is hallelujah. Lift it up.
Saying how in Hebrews 5, how Jesus, when he was in his flesh, offered up prayer and supplication to the Lord. It says with loud cries and tears. And then it says, and his praise was heard because of his reverence for the Lord. And it just reminded me that all of this, ain't about you. It's not about me. It's not about how you feel. It's not about getting you excited. It's not about making you feel good. It's not about titillating your emotions. It's not about helping you cope with the hard parts of your life. It's about a reverence for His Majesty,
that's
King
right.
Jesus.
That's
who
right.
are we talking about? We're talking about Jesus. Jesus, a resurrected King who is worthy of the best that you have to offer. Jesus asked Peter, he said, who do you say that I am? So you're gonna have to make it personal. And so we're gonna sing that chorus again. But this time as we sing it, make it personal. Let that hallelujah be personal. let your praise be an indicator of what Jesus has done and is doing in your life. Can we sing it?
Hallelujah.
Come on, make it personal.
Hallelujah.
Tell him, tell him, tell him, tell him, tell him.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, sing hallelujah.
Jesus, with reverence, with joy, with thankfulness, that is our cry this morning. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. We praise you for what you have accomplished on Easter Sunday. We praise you that the tomb is empty. We praise you that you have ascended into heaven. We praise you that our sin can be forgiven. We praise you that we can be invited into the family of God. We praise you because you are our risen King, worthy of every bit of our praise and more. And because that is true, it is our joy, it is our privilege to offer that praise to you this morning. So we love you, Jesus. We pray these things in your powerful, mighty, holy, and resurrected name. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Come on, let the redeemed of the Lord
amen.
Say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Well, hey, you can go ahead and have a seat. Happy Easter. Welcome once again to Bridgeway. My name is Brian.
My name is Judah.
And we are two of the pastors here, and we are just delighted to have you with us this morning.
Yeah, we're so glad that you chose to spend your Easter Sunday with us. You had a lot of options in this region, and we're appreciative that you are here. We also want to shout out to those of you who are with us online. You are very much a part of this service and this family. We're so glad that you're with us. And we got some folks in the lobby worshiping
God. We see you
out
there, lobby.
We see you out there in the lobby praising God, and we are glad that you are with us this morning.
And we want to extend a special welcome to any of you that if this is your first time here,
right,
or you're new or visiting, we are absolutely honored that you would make us part of your Easter weekend. So thank you for being here.
Yeah.
It's our hope that you just feel right at home with us here at Bridgeway. And if you are new, want to direct you to the back of the seat in front of you, you'll find a card that looks just like this one. It says Connect at the top. And if you want to grab that, fill it out, and after the service, you can bring it out to our Connect Center in our lobby where a member of our team would love to receive that card from you, answer any questions that you might have. And Pastor Judah, I believe we have a gift for them.
You know, we believe in gift giving. We believe in it. So we just want to give you a little something just to say thanks for being here. Just thanks for getting out of your bed, getting in the shower, and coming on down to the house of the Lord and worshiping with us. You know, we just believe it wouldn't have been the same without you. That's what we believe.
Yep.
It would not have been the same without you. So we're glad that you're here.
That is absolutely true. So we're going to move now to the part of our service where we worship through giving. So if you call Bridgeway home and this is your normal time, when you give, want to invite you to prepare for that. If you're new or visiting today, please know you are our guest. Every element of this service is for you except for this one. So please don't feel any obligation to give. But I just want to highlight, like, I'm so proud of so many elements of just what y'all are doing and what kind of we're able to do as a church. And one of them is this, is that this is truly, like, as much as the weekends are incredible, this is a church that believes in the power of community.
Yeah, that's right.
And in a world where friendship is declining and isolation is increasing, we want to be countercultural in that we want to be a church where people can make friends. So that's something that we invest heavily in. And when you give here, that's part of what you're investing in as well. Now, Pastor Judah, you're our young adults pastor.
Yeah.
Talk to us about how you've seen that play out and just the value of community in our young adult ministry.
I just think that the experience is that so much of the transformation that happens in people's lives doesn't come from teachers on this stage.
Yeah.
It comes from conversations that folks are having with other believers, from prayer that people are engaging in with one another. And so in the young adult ministry, we really centralize friendship. We believe that it is a highly theological element. And in this entire church, whether it's small groups, whether it's Bible studies, whether it's classes, we believe that church is better with friends.
Yeah.
And when you give, it creates opportunities for us to gather people around things like food and like activities and build those friendships that then lead to discipleship.
That's absolutely right. Yeah. So talk to us, how can we give, and then let's pray.
Yeah, so there are a lot of different ways you can give. You can text the number on the screen. You can give through the Bridgeway app. You can give through our website, bridgeway.church/give. There are physical receptacles, little black boxes in the back that you can put a physical gift in if you'd like. And if you're trying to find that and you're struggling, anybody with a badge, anybody that's campus guide, anybody that's ERT, or anybody that just to sit next to you, tap on the shoulder and say, help me find the box to put a physical gift in. And listen, whatever you give and however you give, it makes it possible for us to make sure that community is accessible, that the community of Jesus is accessible to anybody who's looking for it. So we're going to pray over our gifts. I'll invite you to pray with me. Jesus, we are generous because you're generous. I often say that, Lord, that we don't give because we're forced to, that giving doesn't make us better people or better Christians. It doesn't buy us any credit in heaven, Lord. We just give because it's what we saw you do over and over again, even unto giving your life. And so, Lord, we are trying to reflect that, and we ask that you would bless our efforts and bless the gifts that we bring. Help us to steward them and use them ultimately for kingdom building work. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
In the vast expanse where waters gleam and sunlight dances on the stream, there stands a painter, mighty and wise, with love that reaches to the skies. With brush in hand, he paints the dawn, each stroke a promise, each hue a song. In water's mirror, his love reflects, a masterpiece not one forgets. But deeper still, beyond the art, resides the beating of his heart. A love so radical, so pure, it holds the universe secure. For in his love we find our light, a beacon shining in the night. And as he paints the world with care, he calls us to his love to share. With every sunrise, each night sky, he shows us how his love abides. In water's flow, in colors bright, his love shines through with pure delight. And so he calls us, one and all, to heed his loving, gracious call, to love like he has loved us first, with kindness overflowing, unrehearsed. For in his love, without condition, we find our purpose, our tenured mission, to spread his love both far and wide, with arms stretched out, hearts open wide. So let us be like waters deep, with love unending for those who seek. For Christ has loved us, oh, so much, and in return, let's love as such.
Amen. Good morning. You know, we truly believe that being in church is a supernatural experience. That every time I have my team pray with me before services, we're praying that God would move even in the midst of while we're doing other stuff. That while you're worshiping, God is touching your heart. That while the preaching's going on, that God is healing you. Because what we were praying is that everybody would feel a touch from the Lord, that everyone would go home with a present, right? A present from the Lord, a present to know that his love for you is real, that it's strong. If you don't feel love today, boy, did we not do our job, right? God loves you in an infinite way. I want to talk about that for a moment. there are three explicit acts that God has done to demonstrate his love that are so obvious, they're unarguable. Number one, creation. That the supernatural deity creator would scoop together with his own hands dirt to fashion mankind, use his own breath to breathe into us, make us into his image. That's all very personal. Second, that the Son of God would leave all that is awesome and come down to that which is not awesome and hang out with us and show us how precious we are to him. And then the cross, right? We were talking about that on Good Friday. The cross was the supreme act. The Bible says that greater love has no man than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. That's exactly what Jesus did. The very act of the cross is simple. It's that in our goodness, we're never going to be good enough. We're never going to be moral enough. We're never going to be perfect enough to scratch our way to heaven. It's not going to happen. It's perfect or it's nothing. So Jesus Christ died for our sins. He died for our condemnation that was deserved. The split between us and God, he made it possible to be rectified. We're going to be talking about that at the end of the message today. But understand this. God wasn't lonely when he created us. He created us out of love. Jesus wasn't bored when he came down to earth. He came down for us. And Jesus never needed to die for his own sins because he didn't have any. Every single thing he did for us. We shouldn't question his love because he's demonstrated it over and over, and yet we still do, right? We're like, man, that was 2,000 years ago. That was the dawn of creation. So what have you done for me lately, right? And then no matter how many sermons we hear that God is still in the process of saving. He's still in the process of pouring out grace. He's still in the process of active loving. We're still looking around and saying, God, do you love me? But here's the good news. The resurrection says that he's alive and he's still doing great things. He's still loving on us. He still has a ton more to give. That's what's so beautiful about all this. He's not gone. The last words he said to his followers were, behold, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. It was not just for those followers. It's for us as his followers. We will never be alone. He watches us when we're not watching ourselves. He intercedes for us when we're just being yahoos. You know what I'm talking about? God is so kind, so gracious, so loving, and he surrounds us, and he's not done. We celebrate the resurrection on Easter, right? And so the next logical question is, after he got up, then what? After he walked out of that tomb victorious, alive, what happened next? A lot of us just stopped the story there, but there's so much more. And if indeed he's resurrected and what he did next proves that he's alive, then what are the implications? What are the ramifications for us? Does it even matter for us? I think it does in a significant way. So I'm going to explain what happened next. You work on the implications for you, right? All right. So in order to do that, would you open up your Bibles? We're going to need to read out of God's word. John chapter 20. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one under the seat in front of you. If you're watching online, make sure to grab a Bible, join on with us. It helps to kind of follow along. You can also open up the app if you need to take notes, stuff like that. But if you're looking at one of the Bibles under the seats, it's going to be page 906. 906, if you're not familiar. If you brought your own Bible but aren't too familiar with it, drop it open in the middle, go to the right. You're going to go quite a ways till you hit Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. There we go. You're going to be in John chapter 20, verse 19. It begins after Jesus has rose from the dead. He revealed himself to who first? Anybody remember? Mary Magdalene. He revealed himself to the female disciples first. He then revealed himself to the two men walking on the road to Emmaus. But he hasn't yet revealed himself to what's called the 12, his main crew. Judas is gone, there's 11 left. You gotta imagine the anticipation is freaking them out. They've heard he's alive, they know his grave is empty, but he hasn't touched base yet. That must have been all in their heads. What does it mean? Why is he delaying? What's going on? Is he mad at us? What's happening, right? And then the Bible records what happened. So let's go ahead and read that. John chapter 20, Verse 19, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Well, first thing I would just suggest is he didn't have to show up. He didn't have to do any of the stuff that he does, but he did. And I would suggest to you that because they had such a close relationship, such an intimate relationship, they had kind of lived together for 3 years. They did everything together. They were in danger together. They saw miracles together. They talked about supernatural things together. So I would imagine the relationship would kind of suggest, well, of course he's going to show up. And now he did. All right, great. Then he says this, "Peace be with you." Which is kind of a weird statement because you go, I thought you guys were, you're close, right? I don't think we all remember how disappointing the team has been since they last talked. Anybody remember that? See, the last time they were all together, they were in a garden. Anybody remember the name of the garden? Gethsemane. What happened there? Jesus was arrested. The Bible says every single one of his teammates bailed. Everyone ran. He was arrested alone. Nobody stayed with him. We know the famous story of Peter's denial, right? Imagine your greatest failure being in the best-selling book of all time. What a drag. We know Peter denied him, who had just said, "I'll die for you." Clearly he's not, right? And then what? I don't know if you noticed this. At the foot of the cross, while Jesus was bleeding out, only the female disciples were there and John. Nobody else had the guts to even be there as he died. That's the last time they hung out. All of a sudden, he shows up. Now, you got to imagine if he's going to be like us, he's ticked off, kicks in the door, right? What's wrong with you guys? Thought we were a team, you know? A bunch of losers, right? He didn't do any of that. He walks in and he says, "Peace be with you," which is a cool way of saying, chill out, guys, we're good, right? Because you know they're nervous. The minute, because it's one thing to have a hero. It's one thing to have a Messiah that you believe in. It's another thing to watch the King of Kings rise from the dead and show up in your room. I mean, their jaws, bam. I mean, it's one thing to expect it, another to anticipate, another thing to what? Walk through it. This is crazy. So they're freaking out. And he says, guys, we're good. I see more than practicality in him showing up. What I see is gentleness. What I see is him walking in quietly. This whole notion that somehow God is always mad at us, that somehow he's got this big hammer in heaven and he's always waiting to beat down on somebody that sinned, I just don't see it anywhere in Scripture. Well, you haven't read the Old Testament. Yeah, I have. It's kind of my job. Read it backwards and forwards, y'all. I know it. I know Jesus. I know God as much as anybody. And here's the truth. He is so kind, so gracious. It takes a lot to get to the point of judgment. By that time, you will even agree with your judgment. Right? So no, I don't see that. What I see is love. What I see is gentleness. How many times has he whispered to you, hey, kiddo, what you're doing is not good? And you know it in your spirit. That's that conviction piece, right? He didn't scream at you, he didn't freak you out. It was a whisper. You were built for more than this, right? Isn't that his way? Verse 20, when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Well, that's kind of weird. If God shows up in your room, is the first thing you want to do is touch him? Nope. Anyone shows up in my room unannounced, I don't want to touch you. I'm not cool with you. I don't know why you didn't call first. Does that make sense? If an angel shows up, not touching him, nope. Nope, I will back up. I'll fall over, I'll do something else, but I'm certainly not touching him. Right? Because here's what's interesting. He says, peace be with you. And he moves up close to them and he says, guys, you can get into my personal space. If you have a beef with somebody, you don't touch them. Otherwise, you're going to throw hands, right? If you got a problem with them, you don't cross over their personal space. Jesus said, listen, we're so good, I need you to be able to come all the way close to me and you can touch me. We're okay. I kid you not. It's reassuring and reassuring and reassuring. But notice he says this, just as I was on mission for my Father, I'm now sending you. Guys, you're back on. You got a job to do. You've had a little bit of a break here. It's now time to go. Y'all know what I'm asking you to do. I want you to go be me. Oh, I can't be you. Yeah, you can. All I'm asking you to do is love on a ton of people and be my ambassador. If I want to heal somebody, I'll heal them through you. If I want to set somebody free, I'm going to do it through you. I just need you to get out there and go love on somebody. And I've given you everything you need. That's what that whole Holy Spirit breathing thing and all that stuff. I've given you power. I've given you authority. I've given you the words to say. You have everything you need to go out there and change the world. Guys, we don't get to sit at home. We don't get to just do our own thing. We don't get to have our own agenda. We are Christians. Therefore, we go and we love on actively, right? Look at verse 24. Now, Thomas, one of the 12 called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. Imagine missing one meeting, and it's the meeting Jesus shows up. You're like, gosh dang it, I'm always the guy that brings sandwiches. I'm at every meeting. I miss one, the Lord rises. What the heck? Right? So the other disciples told him, we saw the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails, which, by the way, is a little creepy. And unless I place my hand into his side, I will never believe. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Can we pause for a moment? Jesus is not good at knocking. I feel like it's just common courtesy, right? Which is odd, because later on he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And we go, did you? I don't think you did. Actually, I'm changing, you know, whatever. Verse 27, then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. And Thomas said, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said, have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me, and yet they still believe. Here's what's crazy about that. He came back for the skeptic. I mean, man, skeptics drive me crazy, right? There's some of you that are like, gotta do it myself, gotta do it myself, gotta do it myself. You know what? I don't like you. You're just like, you're making everything harder on everybody. Just trust me. I can't, right? Okay, now I'm gonna guarantee you that he was such a massive skeptic that the reason he wanted to touch Jesus was because he said, I don't even trust me. I don't trust my own eyes. Because later on, I'm gonna doubt me. I had some weird experience. It probably wasn't real. He is such a skeptic, he has to go, I need all the proof to believe. Why would Jesus show up for somebody like that? Because there is kiddos too. And he's so gentle. He doesn't come in with correction, because here's the deal. For the fact that he walks right up to Thomas and goes, so you need to touch me, right? Means he was listening on the last conversation when Thomas said, I will never believe. How embarrassing is that, getting caught? You know somehow he saw you, but for him to call you on it, that's awkward. And he's like, so you have to touch me, is that it? All right, let's go. Come on, we can do this. Okay, well, I'm good now. No, you're not good. Let's go. Bam, that's what I would have done. Do you feel that? Do you feel, okay, that's right. Jesus is so much nicer than I am. You might want to write that down. Notice he corrects him at the end, but how did he correct him? Here's what he said. Hey, kiddo, I got no problem walking this with you, but here's my problem. You can't just live resistant. I can't prove everything to you. Because I'm going to be talking about all kinds of stuff. If I talk about the Old Testament, what do I got to teleport you back into the Old Testament? Just so you can see that Moses was a real guy? At some point, buddy, you have to trust me. that I am who I say I am, I can do what I say I can do. Because otherwise, if you always look for proof, it almost sounds like I'm serving you. That's not how it works. So I appreciate how I built you to be skeptical, but can we be skeptical in the right ways and not in the wrong ways? What a beautiful, gentle way. What I'm trying to point out is Jesus kept demonstrating his love actively over and over and over again, right? We cannot read the mind of God. Love is felt through action. Love is felt through action. Nobody can read your mind. We can't read the mind of God. It's not until we see a demonstration that we can feel the love. The love may be there, but it doesn't become real for me until I can see it from you. Actions reveal the heart. When Jesus died on the cross, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, a Pharisee, both risked to get his body down from the cross and go put it in their own tomb. Why? Because they loved him so much, they went into action. The women ran to the tomb to anoint the body. Why? Because their love for Jesus compelled them to action. When Jesus reinstated Peter into the ministry as its leader, he said, if you truly love me, you'll love my people. And I need you to do it actively. You can't just think nice thoughts. It's not enough. Love is felt in action. Now, Christianity has always been designed on an overflow principle. The overflow principle is simply this. God never asks you to dredge up something on your own. He never asks you to fake it. He never asks you to make up something that's not there. The overflow principle says he's gonna initiate, pour it into you, then you pour out from the overflow. He, you can give other people grace because he first put grace in you. You can love other people because he first, what? Poured love into you. You can forgive other people because he, what? Forgave you first. He said, kiddos, I'm never asking you to do something I didn't put inside you. I filled you to overflowing. The Bible refers to the actions of the Holy Spirit as rivers of living water. In the ancient world, living water meant running water. It continues to flow. Why? Because God keeps actively loving you. So here's the big question for us. What are you gonna do with all the love in your heart? I mean, if you're all filled up, right? What do you do with a heart full of love? We pour it out.
We are loved by God to love our neighbors. Because he loves us, we have the opportunity to love others well. The great thing about love is that it doesn't care what you look like, where you're from, or even what you've been through. Roseville, California, beautiful place, beautiful people. But just like every other place in the world, it could always use a little bit more care. Love Roseville is a community service day where individuals and organizations bring our resources and efforts together to restore our community. Our mission at Love Roseville is simple. It's service, community, and restoration. All things that are core parts of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Love Roseville is an opportunity for us to collectively be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. In fact, it's because he loves us that we have this amazing opportunity to love others. So join us on April 27th so that together, as a community, we can serve, restore, and love Roseville.
Amen. That is our own pastor, Rodney Gray, who's leading the charge on this. This is not simply a let's go out with Bridgeway's name on it. It just says Love Roseville. It's multi-church. We're all meeting April 27th at the Rock of Roseville. It's a bunch of people coming together. We can keep saying we love our community, but until we do something practically, they can't feel it, right? There are 23 different projects we're all gonna spread out and do. One of them, just to give you an idea, one of them is that we're actually gonna go out and make chemo kits for our local hospitals. So those that are struggling and having to go through a very painful process, you have somebody that's going to love on them. We're gonna go out and minister at the Gathering Inn, which is a local ministry that ministers to the homeless and those struggling with poverty. And then we're gonna go to Roseville High School and do a beautification project just to let the kids know we care about them. Listen, if you want to be a part of that, this is a year of opportunity, right? We've been talking about that at church. Go to loveroseville.org. loveroseville.org. It lets you know all the projects, how to sign up, how to get connected, because we as one whole church, doesn't matter if you're brand new or not, we as one church, along with many other churches, want to go out there and demonstrate to people that we love them. Listen, I'm going to close out with doing something very simple but profound. There are some of us in this room and can hear my voice, watching online, listening on the radio, listening back as a podcast, that you're saying, Pastor, you're asking me to do something I cannot do. I have not felt the love of God. Every time I've loved anybody, I've always tried to drudge it up myself, make it up myself. Well, here's the truth. That's an indicator you're disconnected from your Creator. You were built to be with Him. When He lights you up, He does the initiation. He's your energy. He's your strength. He's your joy. And there's some of us that have never had that happen. The Bible says that His kindness leads us to repentance. In other words, once you feel His love, you gotta change your mind. It's no longer about you, it's about Him. So we're gonna do a two-step prayer. First one is an emptying prayer. Why? Because only the empty portion of a container can be filled, is that correct? But if we're already full of ourselves, there's nowhere for God to pour in. So I'm gonna pray that we would get that garbage out. Pray that everything Jesus did on the cross would be true for us. And we're going to carve out space. Then we're going to pray the second part for the Holy Spirit to pour the love, the grace, and the oil of His forgiveness and His joy into our heart so that we're overflowing. Amen? We're going to go ahead and do that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love You. We are so thankful for You. The stuff that we can see, we're amazed by, and yet the majority we don't see. So Lord, right now we have some in our midst, God, that have already tasted of Your goodness. There's some of us, Lord, who already know Your salvation. We already know that eternal life doesn't begin when we die. It begins right now. And for that, we praise You. But Lord, there's some of us that have yet to fall in love with You. We have yet to have Your love pour down into us. We have yet to let Your forgiveness cleanse us from all our sins. So for those, we begin to pray. Show of hands, anybody need that prayer of emptying out and filling with the love of God? Raise your hand. Anybody need that? Yeah, there's a bunch of us all over. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, pastor's talking about me. That's why I raised my hand. That right now, Holy Spirit, would You allow everything Jesus did on the cross to be true for me? Would You go through with Your burning holy fire and burn out all the garbage? I did my best to live a moral life. I did my best to live what I thought was right. But God, all I have is a trail of tears. All I have is some good points, but I don't have any hope for the afterlife. I actually don't even know if I'm doing this life right. So God, I just pray that You would do what Your word says, that any that call upon the name of the Lord would be saved. So we call upon Your name now. We admit we have been living selfishly and it's not getting us anywhere. So right now we surrender. We empty our cups for You. We say, Lord, take it away. Take away the baggage. Take away the garbage. Take away all that has hindered us. Let it all fall off our shoulders. Let us be free. And in the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, would You pour down into that empty vessel love, grace, forgiveness, joy, peace beyond all understanding. That God, when we emerge from this place, we don't just love because it's a nice thing to do. We love because we can't help it. Lord, would You save us, rescue us, transform us? Your word says that You would take us from the kingdom of darkness where we can't even see what's going on to the kingdom of light. We want that now. And Lord, for those of us that do know the joy of Your salvation, those of us that now together with all those that are brand new with us, we as one family are gonna walk out of here. Lord, may we have the joy of the Lord as our strength. Could we walk out of here, God, in Your power, in Your authority, ready to love on everybody. If they are different than us, it just makes it better. That God, that we would go out into our friend groups, into our workplaces, Lord, anywhere, into our schools, that we might be able to go out and be your ambassador, that just as you sent the disciples, so are we being sent right now. May we go out there and actively love to the glory of your name. And we would do it all with your strength, your power, and your joy. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.